It's a great pleasure and honour to have John Adams here. And I can use no introduction. And if you really want to know who I am, you can look in the programme. John has very kindly not only agreed to take part in a quick question and answer, but you will notice that the rehearsal finished a little early because John is a very efficient and very kind preparer of the orchestra. That means that those people who are going to take part in this question and answer, who are not here, but who are in the Twitter sphere, the blogosphere, the Facebookosphere, possibly a bathosphere, I don't know, but they might not join us until 1 o'clock, which is a little later. But we already have some of the people, the elsewhere people, that have already sent us questions electronically. And I'm just going to read them out because I suspect that some of the issues in these questions might come up with the questions from you, dear audience, who've taken the time and trouble to come, for all I know, across the world to be here today. So, questions, this is just to think about. Could you talk about the use of exotic modes, which means scales, I suppose, in pieces like Slavinsky's Earbox? And then the second question, which is in several parts, basically, what is accessible music? How do you make music accessible? I'm paraphrasing here slightly, so I apologise to the posers of the questions. Does the title come before the composition, or does the composition suggest the title? And lastly, how do you go about writing music for media, i.e. film and or opera? So those, we'll put those on the back burner, although they might suddenly spring up to the front burner. As I now turn the questions over to you, there are, I think, one or two roving microphones. If you'd be kind enough to wait until the microphone gets to you, then we can all hear what you ask. And I might repeat the question so that you have time to phrase the question. So, gentlemen there up at the back, and I'm bound to be unfair to people who want to ask, so as long as I've offended everybody equally, my work will have been done.
Mr. Adams, I'm a great admirer of your music and enjoyed very much the opera Dr. Atomic. But a slight criticism I have is, why on earth did you call it, or did Sellers call it, Dr. Atomic? I know it's a sort of showbiz title, but why did you consider simply calling it Oppenheimer? Trinity.
Let me just repeat the question. Why on earth did you decide to call your opera Dr. Atomic? Were you and or Peter Sellers? Why not call it Oppenheimer? Because it's about Dr. J. Robert Oppenheimer.
Well, there were many reasons for that. The first, I guess, is that, you know, my mother used to sing in Broadway, not real Broadway, but community performances of Broadway. And so I think I inherited a little bit of a showbiz gene, and I wanted a good title that people would, you know, would catch into their heads, like Nixon in China. Nobody's ever forgotten that title. And you know, Oppenheimer. Yeah, I think it would be an okay title, but I think it might send an exceptionally dour message. And Dr. Atomic, first of all, it does have a slight resonance with the 1950s and, you know, science fiction and even comic books. The way a lot of American children learned about nuclear bombs. You know, we unfortunately learned a great deal about this by watching science fiction movies. Also, there was a backdoor reference to Dr. Faustus, because the Faust story is certainly lurking in the background, the story of this very brilliant physicist, Robert Oppenheimer, who had been a left-wing sympathizer during the 1930s and suddenly found himself employed by the U.S. military and, was making this weapon of mass destruction. So there are many, many